So we should, by the end of this, you guys should be able to get through all these objectives and understand them. I'm not going to write them down. You guys shouldn't write them down either. But you guys can take a look at these when I post this if you want. So if you can't do this, come talk to me. Chemistry is the reason why civilization progressed. You know, thousands of years ago, there wasn't much. You know, there was the wheel, which was made of rocks. You know, didn't really go too well because, you know, you go over a speed bump and it cracks. Terrible. Rock wheels. But chemistry is the reason why civilization was able to come to where it is today. And it is important. Way back in the day, what people did for chemistry is they basically did a couple things. They added things to water and they heated them up. So one of the things that they had this green rock, you heated it up, this liquid came out, this really hot orange liquid, which cooled down into a shiny orangish metal. That metal was copper. And that with that copper, people were able to make stuff. And which you think a lot of the stuff that we use in everyday in everyday life, you know, comes from chemistry and was invented by it. Like copper wires, where would we be without copper wires? We wouldn't be able to transmit electricity. And I mean, this was in the last 150 years, so there's been so many revelations and discoveries about this. So this is a little thing from the cartoon guide. It's pretty funny, but without chemistry is the reason why civilization advanced. Like you guys, your history teachers may disagree, but they're wrong. Moving on. Chemical and physical changes. I want you guys to take this down. This is very important. So, chemical and physical changes. Key idea with a chemical change is that a new substance is formed. You have a substance that you didn't start out with that was created by that change. How that happens is the atoms are bonded differently than they were before. So a new type of particle is formed. So if we could take a look at the particles, if we could see them on the tiniest scale, you would see that you have a new particle that wasn't there in the beginning. I like to think about atoms like Legos. So like if you can imagine, you guys all played with Legos. I played with Legos. It's great. When I was a kid and this weekend, you know. So you can imagine each different type of Lego is like an atom. Like you can have like your 6-pip Legos, your 5-pip Legos, your 10-pip Legos. Each of those would be like a different atom. And if you took them and you constructed something by putting them together, that's like a chemical change because your Legos are in a different formation than they were before. A physical change, the substance is the same substance that you started with. The atoms, the actual individual particle is bonded the exact same way. And what they what happens there is the particles are moving around. They change position. I like to think about the P's. Physical is a P, particle position change. Okay? So you're just moving the particles around. So that would be like constructing your different Legos and then playing with them, just moving them around. But you're actually not taking apart the individual Lego vehicles or devices. Okay? Whereas if you did take them apart and put them together in a different way, that's a chemical change. Make sense? All right. So moving on. So physical change, this is a good example. Liquid going to water. Sorry, liquid water becoming gas water or water vapor. So what's happening here is the actual water particle remains intact. So, but you're just moving around the particles. So that's why it's a physical change. Because the H2O particles don't actually separate the atoms from each other. They remain the same. Whereas hammering is also another physical change. You know, copper, you hammer it down, it's still copper. You have the same substance. The particles themselves are intact. You're just moving them around or separating the particles, but they're the exact same particles. Chemical changes, hydrolysis. Hydro meaning water, lyse meaning to break. hydrolysis, actually taking apart the individual water atoms, and you're recreating them in a different way. Notice what happens to the formulas in a physical change. Evaporation, you start with H2O. What do you end with? H2O. Copper, you start with copper, you end with copper. Chemical change, we start with H2O. We have new types of substances being formed that we didn't have originally, like hydrogen and oxygen. So that's one way that can help you identify it. By the models, you can see that in order to get your final products, you actually have to take apart your reactants and put them together in a different way. Combustion of methane. This is another one. This is what goes on in the Bunsen burners and on your gas stoves at home. You have CH4, which is natural gas, or what we call it in chem is methane. And if you're in England, they call it methane. So I studied in Ireland briefly. That was awesome. I highly recommend going abroad. And I was very confused with a couple things, like aluminium and methane. I thought there were new substances, but no, it's just aluminum and methane with a British accent or Irish accent. And you take apart the atoms and put them together in this different way. You make carbon dioxide in the water. So you have new atoms bonded to differently than they were in the beginning, which makes it a chemical change. Why don't you guys take a sec and look at So Sarah, what is number one? It is physical. Why is that? Dissolving is a physical change. Going from solid to aqueous. You guys may have noticed this place called the ocean. When you go swimming in there, you come out, the water evaporates. What happens to the salt? It stays. It's all over your skin. You can actually lick your skin, assuming you guys are clean. And you can taste it after you go down in the ocean. It's pretty cool. So the salt stays there. It's going from aqueous to solid. That process is physical change. What about number two, Brendan?
It's a chemical change.
Why is that?
Because you had KCl, but then it divides into K and Co.
Great. Sasha, number three, what is that one?
It's a chemical change.
Yep. Why?
Because particles are bonding to one another.
What do you mean? Okay, yep. But the key thing is the atoms are moving around. I think you were... use the term particle for an atom. So like a particle of this is CH4 actually. A particle of CH4 or whatever this is this entire group. And the atoms which make them up are the individual circles. Okay. So we have to move around the atoms and break them apart and put them together in a different way. Atom number four. Okay. Why is that? Yeah, we're just mixing them up. Just because you mix something doesn't mean there's a reaction, too. It's like the match.com. Just because you put two people together doesn't mean there's going to be chemistry. Sorry. Properties of matter, this is also important. Right? So physical property, the key thing though there, it can be observed without changing the substance. So like, for instance, I can measure the mass of a substance, and I'm not changing the substance. It's the same substance. Whereas a chemical property, I have to change the substance in order to observe this. Like a reactivity to air. That reactivity to air would be required to change the substance. So that's why that's a chemical property. Chemical properties can be observed only by changing the substance, whereas physical properties can be observed by without changing it. Like I can measure the temperature of something. Of the air, I'm not actually changing the air. Whereas if I'm measuring if I'm determining the oxidation of citric acid, I would actually have to change the citric acid to see that property. Also, extensive and intensive properties, another difference in properties. Extensive properties depend on how much matter there's present. So mass is an example of an extensive property. The more mass I have, or the more matter I have, the more mass there is. An intensive property is independent of amount. So, for instance, density. Density is a property. It doesn't matter how much I have, how much water I have, it's going to have a constant density. I can have a small amount of water. It's going to have a density of 1 gram per milliliter. I have a large amount of liquid water. It's going to have the same density. So it's independent of amount. I think we have a quiz later in the week. I think it's Friday. It's on the calendar. It's either Thursday or Friday. So we'll do more of this stuff tomorrow, guys. Good job. Thank you. What's that? The homework?
It's on the website.
I posted it up there. I will...